This is the Comics Alternative Manga, reviews of Red Rock and Other Stories, and the Osamu Tezuka Story. Hello and welcome to another episode of the Comics Alternative Manga. I'm Derek.
And I'm Shea.
And we're two guys with PhDs, or someday to get PhDs, talking about manga. And on this month's episode of the manga series, Shea and I are going to be talking about a couple of really interesting books. We're going to begin with Red Rock and Other Stories, 1967 through 1970, from Seiichi Hayashi. And then after that, we're going to look at a tome of the text, the Osamu Tezuka Story, A Life in Manga and Anime, created by Toshio Ban and Tezuka Productions. But before we get into that discussion, we want to let all of you guys know that this episode of the Comics Alternative Manga is brought to you by the great folks at Discount Comic Book Service. Go to their website, dcbservice.com, for all of your comics pre-ordering needs. There, you're going to find all DC, Marvel, Image, and Dark Horse titles at 40% off the cover price if you pre-order. For all of the other publishers, you'll find that those discounts are 20 to 35% off of the cover price. And every month, you're going to find some wonderful, unbelievable specials. Sometimes those specials will be at 45% off cover price, sometimes at 50% off cover, but often the discounts can go higher than that.
Like this month, you can get volumes of Bakuman, which we've mentioned on the show before, for 30% off. And you can get volumes of Cross Game, which I've heard very good things about, for about 30% off.
That's right. You can find great discounts on manga and other things. So go to the website and check it out. That's dcbservice.com. Go there for all of your comics pre-ordering needs. And after you do get your manga there, please be sure to send them an email and tell them that Shea and Derek sent you. Shea, how have things been going for you this summer?
They have been good. I've been doing a little bit of work for you, actually.
Uh-huh.
And that's just about done, and I will be glad to finish that here in the next day or two. But other than that, you know, just working hard on some good comic stuff.
Yeah. Now, you know, work for me. Let's just point out that, you know, this is not anything like, you know, I'm having you do manual labor in my backyard.
Yes.
You know, you're not clearing land. You're doing an essay for a collection that I'm working on. So,
yes.
So this should be great. I'm looking forward to this contribution, and we can talk about it more as we get further along in the production. Right now, you and I have enough to talk about with the July manga show, so you want to jump into that?
Yes. In the last couple seconds, I was thinking about how we could start talking about this book, and
Red Rock.
I got nothing. So do you want to take a shot at describing this this collection of short stories?
Yes, Seiichi Hayashi's Red Rock and Other Stories. This is a collection of his writing, most of which was originally published in Garo between 1967 and 1970. In fact, if we look in the table of contents, I think all but two of the stories in this collection are from Garo. The other two, for instance, Red Enamel Shoes, which is weird, and Madam D, which is also very weird, came from the publication A Woman's Self.
Mm-hmm.
Appropriately enough.
Yes.
Yeah. And maybe a way of getting into Red Rock in this collection of stories is maybe to set a context about any of our own experiences or expectations coming to Hayashi's work.
So I was the one who suggested this book because I am a huge fan of Hayashi, but you were someone who was less familiar with his work, and I don't think you had read any of the stuff that that had been translated in English. So what were your kind of thoughts and feelings about this as someone who was kind of new to his his style.
Well, you know, I don't know as much about his work as you do, but I have read some of his previous work. So I was familiar with his book, Red Colored Elegy, and this was published by Drawing Quarterly, I don't know, maybe about 2008, something like that, several years ago.
Yeah.
So that was my first exposure to Hayashi's work. Mm-hmm. And then I've also read some of the stories that were collected in Golden Pollen and Other Stories by Picture Box. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the great Picture Box that we unfortunately no longer have. Mm-hmm. Much to the chagrin of comics and especially manga lovers. So I knew that Hayashi's work was... Well, I knew he was part of Garo, alternative manga, unusual, different kind of narrative style. But I think that even knowing both Red Colored Elegy and some of the stories in Gold Pollen and Other Stories, I wasn't completely set up for the stories in Red Rock, which were actually published before the other things, the stories collected in Gold Pollen and Red Colored Elegy. Because as experimental as, for instance, Red Colored Elegy, which is a longer form narrative, right? I mean, I guess we could call it a graphic novel. It's a longer story. It's different. It's unusual. Definitely alternative. But there is a tangible narrative that is there. In other words, you read, at least my experience with Red Colored Elegy, there were times that I wasn't exactly sure what's going on, but I just continued reading. And so just pulling back, I could get a larger sense of the story that's being told, albeit experimentally. In Red Rock, though, some of these earlier stories, we get to see, I think, an even more experimental Hayashi in that at times I would even question the presence of a coherent narrative.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's actually – so you read a physical copy of the book, right?
Yes.
So I was reading a PDF of the book on my computer and and some of the PDFs we get for manga are formatted weirdly, where they're kind of formatted backwards, and so you have to go to the last page and kind of read backwards. And I started reading the PDF of Red Rock, and this is just a testament to how kind of weird Hayashi's manga is. Anyways, I got about halfway through the book before I realized that I had been reading it the wrong direction. and I had to go back and reread. I had to go back and start at the actual beginning and read through it and finish it and read through all that.
So you started with the end of Madame D.
Yeah. And, and I read, you know, maybe 50, 60 pages. And I was like, this is weirder than it normally is. but I kind of just went with it. And then I stopped and I was like, no, this doesn't make any sense. And I had to go back and look, and it turns out I was reading it backwards. But that is, just a testament to how strange some of these stories are and how kind of at times almost nonsensical that you could read them backwards and just, that's just, a quirk of the, you just chalk it up to, these are weird comics. and it's especially the stuff that is in the back of the book is particularly weird. Looking at the first couple stories in this, like The Devil is Son and The Unbeatable Soul, it's much more coherent. It's much more
and our
linear.
Mother. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. It's definitely these first couple stories are things that you couldn't really do that with because they are more coherent and more kind of linear and. It's just to give listeners an idea of how strange some of these comics that we're talking about are.
Exactly. Now, it's interesting that you had this experience of starting to read the book via the PDF backwards and then realizing halfway through, oops, I didn't think that I was reading this backwards until now. And it didn't dawn on you any earlier. And that makes sense to me. When you were saying that, I couldn't help but think of Seiichi Maki, that we read his Ding Dong Circus on the show back in very late December. Now, I think of all the manga that you and I have discussed, on this mm-hmm. manga series, and you know, we've been going for over a year now. Mm-hmm. So we've read a good bit of manga, a variety, I would say. Mm-hmm. But on, let's say, one, if there's a spectrum between, let's say, conventional storytelling on one end, like the extreme conventions, even formulaic modes of storytelling on one end of the spectrum, mm-hmm. and the other is, you know, is complete abstract, non sequitur kind of storytelling, then I'd say that something like Ding Dong Circus, Maki's mm-hmm. Ding Dong Circus, is closer to that second end, right? The mm-hmm. the very abstract, discontinuous narrative, if there's anything narrative at all in some of those stories. And I think that Red Rock, the stories in Red Rock, and you're right, especially the ones toward the end or in the last half of this collection, they would be definitely closer to the non-narrative, abstract mm-hmm. end of the spectrum. But I think not near as, I guess, as abstract as Ding Dong Circus was. Because Ding Dong Circus, yes, there were stories in some of those pieces, you know, where you could tease out what mm-hmm. they may be. But I think it's a little clearer in Red Rock, but mm-hmm. with some of the stories, not necessarily so.
Right. I think when we talked about Ding Dong Circus, you know, and part of it is informed by the kind of essay that Holmberg included from Sasaki Maki himself. But, you know, reading and rereading that book, I began to kind of read those as almost these visual poems where the relationships between the images aren't supposed to be kind of linear or logical or
Ding Dong Circus you're talking about.
Right, yeah. Right. They're just kind of these impressions that are loosely related, these feelings, these emotions that are loosely related. I definitely felt that the stuff in Red Rock is akin to the work in Ding Dong Circus, but there's definitely a more logical relationship between the panels in Red Rock, even if the narrative or the kind of loose narrative that Hayashi has running through some of these are not that easy to discern or make out. There's definitely a more narrative or narrative oriented relationship between the images than Maki. But I definitely had that same feeling that you did, that they were very much akin. And you know, I've read other stuff from Garo that, you know, but I think those two books, this and Ding Dong Circus, are definitely the most avant-garde,
right?
Shall we say?
We're talking about Ding Dong Circus. We should mention, because I don't think we have yet, that the publisher mm-hmm. of Red Rock and Other Stories is Breakdown Press, also the publisher of Ding Dong Circus.
Right, and it's, you know, it has. It's translated and edited by Ryan Holmberg, who provides a nice essay, and we've talked about the work he's done before. Mm-hmm. This is the second Hayashi collection, I think they've translated. The other one being Flowering Harbor, which I actually haven't read. Red Color Elegy, but Flowering Harbor is very similar to the kind of the description you provided for that. It's a longer form work. It's much more narrative oriented than the stuff in Golden Pollen and Other Stories mm-hmm. or Red Rock.
Yeah. Now, thinking again about Ding Dong Circus, all of those stories, except for I think one, mm-hmm. were published in Gatto between 1967 and 1971. Mm-hmm. So basically around the same time as the stories that we have in Red Rock.
Right.
Yeah. So this is definitely, along with Ding Dong Circus, maybe a pinnacle, we could say, for at least for what we know of the kind of abstract or avant-garde storytelling to be found in Gatto, at least accessible to English readers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is the kind of work that that most publishers would not take a chance on, because it is, you know, I think listeners can tell that it's difficult to describe. It's difficult to sell to people.
Yeah. Now, some of the stories in this collection are shorter, or on the shorter mm-hmm. side of things, or at times quite short, and others are longer. And maybe we can talk about some of the individual stories that struck our fancy or that, for mm-hmm. whatever reason, stood out to us. And one of the ones that's longer that I particularly found interesting is Our Mother.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that immediately struck me about the story, Our Mother, is that we had a repetition of some characters that we had in the earlier two stories. So the first two stories in this collection, you've already mentioned, you know, the devil, his son, and the uneatable soul, and then Oh in the Dawn's Early Light. And you know, the thing notable about Oh in the Dawn's Early Light, you have kind of a takeoff of Batman, or just superheroes in a broader sense, which I think is funny. And we find, you know, a topic of conversation for this collection would be Hayashi's engagement with pop culture, which I'm sure we'll do. But getting back to Our Mother, the character of the frog, Kero Kishi, the young frog who is separated from his parents, we had seen frog characters in the previous story, but we also saw in the previous story another character who he's referred to as Gorilla, correct? The one who looks like a wizard?
Master Gorilla, yeah.
Master Gorilla, right. So he plays a major role here, and we saw him briefly in that previous story, you know, Oh, in the Dawn's Early Light. But he seems to play another kind of character. So one of the things that I couldn't help but think of is, again, getting back to Ding Dong Circus, if you remember, we talked about certain characters or images that kept cropping up again and again throughout Monkey Stories in that collection. And at first, at least with the first stories, I thought we were going to get something similar here, the same kind of characters, the same images, almost iconic at times, cropping up again and again. And we got a little of that, but as we go into the book, I think there seems to be less of that repetition.
Yeah, there's I don't want to say continuity, but there is this kind of like, because I don't know if they are the same characters, but there's definitely a connection between those first couple stories where you do see these similar characters and similar looking characters, where they're those first couple are much more contiguous than the later stuff where it just becomes totally bonkers. So I definitely see what you're talking about, and I'm picking up the same sort of things, but I'm not entirely sure what to what ends Hayashi was doing that for.
Yeah. Another thing about that story, Our Mother, that I particularly liked was the fact that, I mean, in some ways, this is probably one of the most coherent story-wise of this collection, because you can ferret out a narrative line. And so we have this character, what did I say his name was? Kero Kichi, right. And he's separated from his parents. His parents seem to be destroyed in an atomic blast. Rather telling that a Japanese artist is depicting this. And then he is, I don't know if I'd call it trained by Master Gorilla, but this wizard-like figure. But he's taken under his wing to be cared for. And so you have kind of a growth narrative here, and then it all leads up eventually to him, it seems to be, rediscovering his parents. And, of course, on the second to the last page, he's calling out to his mother, and then he does see what seems to be his mother, which is, it seems to me, a combination between the Statue of Liberty, American consumerism, and Marilyn Monroe.
Yep, and she's holding
a Coke bottle instead of the torch.
And instead of I can't recall what's in the Statue of Liberty's left hand, but instead of that, this Marilyn Monroe figure is holding a book that cover reads "How to Cure Frigidity Sex."
And she's also holding her right breast.
Breast, yes. Yeah. So there's a lot going on in this story and the preceding story, which has that that Batman-like character. You know, we definitely see, you know, you mentioned Hayashi's engagement with pop culture, and her, you know, Holmberg's essay in the back is pretty lengthy, and it's devoted to Hayashi and the scene he was kind of working in
right
at this time's kind of engagement and interrogation and relationship with intertextuality and pop art and American culture and Japanese culture, and we definitely see that prominently in these first couple stories. Was there any other stories that you thought really stood out for you that you recall really vividly?
Well, in addition to Our Mother, and I guess maybe it's the longer ones that really strike me more, but the second one that stands out to me is Flower Poem.
Mm-hmm.
And this it's somewhat similar to the earlier ones in that there does seem to be, if not a repetition of image or character, at least something that looks somewhat similar. So we were talking about by the Dawn's Early Light, there's this Batman-type character. Even mm-hmm. though we don't have the exact same figure, there are these characters in flower poetry that do seem to have – or flower poem that seem to have that same, I don't know, almost Batman-like look.
Right.
Except there's a group of them, and they seem to be – I mean, and they're flying in on a teacup in a saucer.
Yeah.
I mean, it's strange. Again, Shea and I are trying to describe the kind of art that we have with Hayashi, and sometimes it may be difficult to describe. And so if it sounds really weird, it is.
If listeners are – I'm really glad that Holmberg, wrote the essay that he did and that he included some of the examples that he did because, if listeners had – I hadn't picked up on this before, but once Holmberg mentioned it – there's a lot of similarities between the kinds of images and the kind of kinds of compositions and subject matter that Hayashi draws upon with the Japanese poster artist Tadanori Yoku, who Paul Pope and Ron Wimberly have talked about as well as being in, and I think Anya Davidson and Alex Deegan have also talked about being big influenced on them, but if listeners are familiar with some of the poster work that Yoku has done, they'll have a pretty strong sense of the kinds of really weird, quasi-surrealist pop imagery that Hayashi draws upon pretty heavily. But you're right, it is very weird, and if you haven't seen it, it's describing it sounds almost kind of insane.
Yeah, and in many ways, reading this, I couldn't help but think of the kind of psychedelic art we had in the late 1960s.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's mm-hmm. there's some of that there. In fact, I'm looking at a couple of pages here of Flower Poem, and this is a very close relative to the kind of art that we see in the animated film Yellow Submarine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's... If it was in color, maybe it would look like Brendan McCarthy's work.
Mm-hmm.
It has that same sort of very imaginative, very bizarre, very loose imagery. Yeah. Or when you mentioned that, I started thinking of kind of American psychedelic work, and it does kind of remind me of the cover for Jimi Hendrix's Axis Bold as Love album, that very weird kind of like Indian aesthetic sort of psychedelia that he was working with at that period. Mm. I think that's the best way to give people who haven't seen this a good idea of what kinds of images that Hayashi is drawing on is to... Because, I can't describe it without sounding like a lunatic.
Okay, so I gave you a couple that stood out to me, those longer stories, Our mm-hmm. Mother and Flower Poem. What about you? Which stories in this collection really stood out, do you think, hit you more?
I was thinking about that, and that's really tough because, to me, there wasn't a narrative in these that... That really struck me, that really stood out to me. But each of these stories has some really, really amazing aesthetic stuff going on that I really was taken by. Flower Poem has a couple pages that look they look almost like Gary Panter comics. They look like these experimental art comics from the 1980s or early 1990s. There's other ones that kind of look like Mobius comics almost. There's some that look, some of these later stories that remind me a lot of Seijin Suzuki's movie Tokyo Drifter, which Ryan Holmberg also talks about a little in his essay. You know, there's this moment in Red Red Rock. It's I guess like the second or third page. It's just this little moment where this Yakuza looking guy shoots at Mickey Mouse. He has like a kind of like a Charles Atlas body with Mickey Mouse's head, and this Yakuza guy just blows his brains out. That seems kind of almost totally unrelated to the events of the other stories. I really like that moment.
I like that as well.
I'm looking for this story later in the book. I'm trying to find the name of it, but it's Red Bird, Little Bird, which is one of the later stories, and it looks almost like like Frank Miller drew it within the last year or two. These first couple pages that are these super expressionistic black and white images that are you know, the shapes and the kind of figures are delineated by being these white figures on this black background, and it's, you know, it's got these like ink splatters across the panels. It really does look like Frank Miller's recent work.
Yeah. Let me pause for a moment if I could. And you said black and white. Now in the PDF, is that how it appears?
It's like a deep, deep, deep red.
Okay. Yeah. It's a I would say kind of a dark reddish brown.
Right. Yeah. That's how it appears on my phone, but okay. on my computer or my tablet. On my computer, it shows up as a black. But yeah, on the iPad, it's just like a dark red. But yeah, it's that same sort of figuration and style of rendering, and I was just really taken with, you know, throughout this book, the kind of breadth of aesthetics that Hayashi works with, and the fact that it was able to remind me at certain points of Frank Miller, of Paul Pope, of Gary Panter, of Mobius, of Tadanori Yoku, of Seijin Suzuki, of you know, Betty Boop, of Tezuka. You know, he's drawing on all of these different aesthetics, and he's mashing them up and colliding them into something that you know, when you sit down and read the whole thing and you look at these moments juxtaposed next to each other and connected to one another, they're totally unlike anything I've read, and I did really appreciate moments like that, you know, where Mickey Mouse is literally murdered. That, you know, reminded me of some of the other Garo work that anti-imperialist, anti-consumer, kind of leftist avant-garde art that you see in other collections that Holmberg's translated and that have recently shown up from those Garo guys. But yeah. Now, I don't know if there's one or two stories that really stand out for me. It's really just those moments where, right, I was deeply, deeply impressed with his versatility and his skill as an artist, as an illustrator, as a craftsman, as a thinker, as a writer, that really stand out for me.
Now, you mentioned that scene in the story Red Red Rock, the titular story, where the guy shoots Mickey as he's running. And you're right. I mean, that is striking. I mean, not only the fact that he shoots this Mickey Mouse character, but the, you know, one could say blood, but also ink that seems to be spilling out of him once he's shot.
Right.
Now, that reminded me of
another... It's like his – in the – that the second that he, so there's, it's like a three panel sequence, or I guess it's a four panel sequence where, you know, Mickey Mouse is running, and then in the second panel the guy shoots, and I really like the way that his, you know, the smoke is rendered, or the gun, the sound effect, all of it is rendered as this kind of like almost like a thought balloon,
right
where it comes out and it's, you know, it's a balloonish kind of puffy cloud, but then in that third panel Mickey Mouse is lying on the ground, and it's almost two dimensional where his ears have kind of converged with the kind of pool of blood, and it, you're right, it is definitely reminiscent of ink rather than blood. Yeah.
Well, I mentioned that because in the previous story, Red Enamel Shoes, there's a lot of this same imagery in terms of, if not blood, then something dark and drippy that appears throughout. And I said that it's been, usually it was the longer stories that stood out to me in this collection, but I have to say the story almost in the exact middle, Red Enamel Shoes, strikes me as the most poignant for what it says. I mean, it also, this also seems to be the most psychologically impactful and maybe even political in a different sense from maybe the anti-corporate Disney kind of thing that you were mentioning. But, you know, this is a story, Red Enamel Shoes, about a man or men and the way that women are treated. And so here it seems to be, I mean, this is one of those pieces that you can kind of tease out a story to a point. There's a mother and daughter, and both of them seem to be in different ways involved with this one man who apparently is known for his red enamel shoe, because we really never see his face, but we see his leg, or we see his shoes. And there are times in this story where, especially toward the end, that there is this dripping liquid that I had mentioned. At one point, for instance, I'm looking at page 178, and as the mother and daughter are talking, then this dark substance is oozing out of the television set. And then on the next page, it seems to be coming from, I guess, it's the young girl. So here you have, you know, blood, and of course, if we're talking about women, you know, is this menstrual blood? Is this the result of a violent act? And then we turn the page, and we do have the same kind of dark liquid in a teacup. And then dripping off of the top of the house. And so, I mean, there's something really sinister about this, and I think that that feeds into the message of this story. The red enamel shoes, and then you turn the page and you're into the story Red Rock, and then you have a similar kind of oozing, dripping, dark substance going on.
Right. It's I hadn't noticed that that relationship between the kind of texture of that blood in Red Rock with the kind of oozing, goopy liquid that is very present in the last couple pages of in Red Enamel Shoes. And it's interesting that I hadn't thought too much about this point either, about Red Enamel Shoes, which I, like you, I enjoyed quite a bit. But this story kind of stands out from Hayashi's over a little, because and this is something again that Holmberg mentions in his story, but it's something that's pretty apparent if you've read Golden Pollen and especially Flowering Harbor and some of the other stories in Red Rock. Hayashi's relationships or parental child relationships are really focused on the relationship between mothers and sons, whereas this story is more it's more clearly about this relationship between, on some level, about a daughter and a mother. And so it is unusual because it's a relationship that Hayashi doesn't come back to repeatedly throughout throughout his body of work. So I definitely have to read Red Enamel Shoes a couple more times, because you're right, there's something there, but it's not entirely clear what. But yeah, that's another story that I think really works well within this collection. And just looking through those again, that goopy kind of inky liquid appears a couple times on throughout Red Rock. There's a couple pages where it does recur.
Yeah, and then we have a different kind of liquid in another story I particularly liked, and that is Red Handkerchief. And this is a rather short one, but this is the one that seems to be defined most by photographic imagery, or those which seems to be images that seem to be photographic in nature. It's like he's taken them and made something other. And these seem to be pop culture images. For instance, the story begins on page 216 with a guy shooting a gun down into the leg of another guy whose body seems to be beneath the surface of a puddle. And then in the panel underneath this, the woman is asking, who may be the same guy, you know, even my life I entrusted to you. And so these images here could be something straight out of film or a movie poster. And then we have on that following page, underneath the panel where you say, today I had a dream, it looks like Marilyn Monroe is teasing the world, the globe.
Yeah, this is another one that is kind of reminiscent of not I don't want to say the kind of work that Sasaki Maki was doing in Ding Dong Circus, but there is a story in there that's composed all out of these kind of black and white, slightly altered photographs. And so that kind of technique is something that we see a couple times through Red Handkerchief on that first page. And then in on the third and fourth page, there's a couple instances where it does appear like Hayashi was using that same kind of technique or tool to manipulate photographs and include them in the story. And it would be interesting to find out where he exactly took those from, to see what the kind of relationship between the story or the work was, and the kind of the intertextual, to examine and interrogate that, the intertextual component a little more deeply and insightfully.
Yeah, and you have something somewhat similar in the last story, Madame D, mm-hmm. in that they're images that look to be very photographic.
Right, they look like they're traced, but right. It's interesting that in this story, almost none of those traced figures have mouths. It's only these very heavily cartooned, this guy with, they have dialogue and whatnot, but no mouths, except for this one guy who's very heavily cartooned, very heavily stylized, and the more realistic looking people don't have mouths at all.
Right. Now, one thing I wanted to ask you is regarding Hayashi, what's the deal with Red? Because we have in this collection, we have the stories Red Enamel Shoe, Red Rock, mm-hmm. The Red Spot, Red Bird, Little Bird, Red Handkerchief, all following one right after another. And then we have the book that I mentioned previously, Red Colored Elegy.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of red here.
There is.
He is well read.
He is. I'd be curious to see how exactly these were printed, if this this red color that kind of runs through them is something that Holmberg or the people at Breakdown Press added to for like thematically make it more consistently, or to underline that a little bit. Because you're right, there is, the red handkerchief, red enamel shoes, red rock. It is something that recurs throughout the stories in this book, but it's not something. And then you have, red colored elegy. But aside from those, four or five stories that were all published around the same time, even Red Colored Elegy was published around 1970, 1971. Originally, at least to my knowledge, you don't see that recurring. I can't recall anything in, maybe there is, maybe Red Dragonfly, maybe that's a story I'm thinking of that's in Golden Paulding, but it is, it's not something that appears kind of consistently throughout his body of work, or what I know of his body of work, but it is something that kind of shows up kind of, here and there. But I'm not sure what the significance of Red is to him, even to these stories, honestly.
Yeah. Well, Picasso had a blue period, so maybe this is Hayashi's Red.
Right. It's possible that he was just working through something, and there's something that, maybe when more of his work gets translated and we have more biographical information, more critical work on his work, that we'll be able to puzzle out. But you're right, there's definitely something there. He was definitely obsessed with Red, or interested in Red, or trying to communicate something with Red. But I got nothing on exactly why he might have been been doing that. I can't, unless you see, because it's in the title of five or six of his stories that are, in this and in a couple other collections and translations. But I don't see a specific significance to the color red. I don't even see, in the stories themselves, I'm not seeing a specific invocation of the color red, or or use or interrogation of the color red, or significance of the color red in the stories. So
right.
I got nothing on this one. Did you have like a, maybe a guess or a theory?
No, I just found it interesting. You know, before we leave this collection, though, I do want to mention something that I was thinking of when you started to discuss the latter stories, like Matt and D and Red Handkerchief, with those images that look to be traced or reworkings of photographic images. In terms of style, almost the complete opposite can be found in the story earlier in the book, Flower Falling Town. And to me, this is probably, in terms of artistic style, the closest to, and I use this this description loosely, traditional manga, or the kind of manga that we're used to. This looks the closest to that more than any other story in the book, especially the young kid and the older man who has the hat and the little either Hitler or Charlie Chaplin mustache, your pick. But now the style is more reminiscent of the kind of manga that most people are used to, but the tone of the story, I mean, this is very dark. It's very much like Red Enamel Shoes in terms of what it says about male-female relations. And this may be even darker in that, you know, it starts off with this young boy who is wearing a towel like a cape. He comes running to the old guy, you know, yelling, "Uncle, uncle!" And he mentions that another character, a girl, Seiichi's come out. And so the man runs after him, and we find out that Seiichi is this young girl who seems to be mentally slow in some way. We don't know exactly how, but as the story unfolds, this man, who at first seems to get a big kick out of messing with this girl along with the boy, you know, making fun of her, because at one point the boy pees in the street and then tells her to lick it up. And this man laughs at that and kind of encourages it. But then things take a really dark turn when he abuses her, I mean, sexually abuses her, and then ends up hanging himself because of that. I mean, wow. I mean, to talk about the way that the art looks and how that contrasts with the darkness toward the end of this story is quite striking.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you on the way this comic looks. It's you know, we'll talk about a little bit more about this stuff specifically, and we talk about our next book. But you know, it does remind me, not in the way Hayashi kind of lays out a page or pastes a page, but the way some of these characters look is really reminiscent of the early kind of manga of Osamu Tezuka, the more his you know, his first couple work. I'm thinking in specifically a book like The Mysterious Underground Man.
Right.
But it has this very crude, cartoonish, childish, innocent almost aesthetic with that very, very dark and almost puzzling.
Yeah, statutory rape and suicide. It doesn't get much darker than that.
Right, and you know, I guess that's the problem with avant-garde art, is that it doesn't reveal itself too easily what exactly it's saying or why exactly it's saying that. But I like that, even though you're right, it's a pretty nasty story, I think. And it is not the only one in here that is, where the sexual component is pretty maleficent. It's pretty, you know, I'm thinking that one I was talking about earlier that looks like Frank Miller. Which story is that? You know, that those couple pages that do look like Frank Miller stories are or Frank Miller.
Red Handkerchief? Kind of,
no, it's not Red Handkerchief. It's the one after Red Rock, right?
The Red Spot? It's one of the red stories.
Yeah, red bird, little bird. These first couple pages, you know, that I said look like recent Frank Miller work, you know, the figures you can make out are clearly Japanese soldiers, and they're clearly having sex with women, and I would hazard to guess that they are raping them, and that it's Hayashi making a comment on the role of comfort women in Japan, or it's a criticism of Japan's like rape of Nanking in World War II. You know, because that is a consistent theme through a lot of these Garo works. They are, their politics are pretty far to the left, and they're anti-imperialist, they're anti-militarization. They are critical of Japan's militarized kind of society at this period and Japan's military history. So I would argue that it's probably a criticism of that kind of gross and grotesque military history. But it is just another example of the instances where sexuality, where there is a sexual component to these stories, or at least one that you can easily make out, is pretty violent. It's concomitant with violence, in fact. And so it is interesting that he draws these kind of relationships between sexuality and violence. It's reading these stories in one volume, you do see these connections between his work that I don't know if I otherwise would. Yeah.
Well, Shea, do you want to turn to something a little more innocent, I guess, and that is our next book?
It is much more palette, I will grant you.
Yeah. And this is the Osamu Tezuka Story, A Life in Manga and Anime. Mm-hmm. This is produced by Toshio Ban and Tezuka Productions, translated by Frederik L. Schott, and published by Stonebridge Press. Mm-hmm. And at the top of the show, when I said that this is a tome, it is. I mean, if you discount the appendix, we're looking at a solid 869 pages of manga here.
Mm-hmm.
That is a lot. And I think, Shay, when you and I decided a couple of months ago when we first saw this solicited that we were interested in doing this, because this is, you know, as the title says, the story of Osamu Tezuka. So this is a biography. Mm-hmm. And we were interested in this, but neither of us knew how long this book is.
Yeah, I would have figured it would be, you know, there's a Tezuka, you know, he lived to about 60, and he did live a pretty full life, I'd say. And so I knew there was, but not just that. I mean, he innovated in manga, and he stayed ahead of the curve in manga for his whole career. He worked in anime, he traveled, he was an amateur entomologist, and he was a physician.
Let's not forget that.
Right. He graduated from medical school, and he's technically a doctor. And you know, he lived through World War II and all that, and so, you know, I knew there would be a lot to draw on, but I had no idea that it would be so lengthy and it's a pretty, I got it and I described it to my fiance as a doorstop, because it is gigantic.
It is, and it's interesting that how this biography is told, because, and I like this. It's a story of Osamu Tezuka told through the voice of one of his characters, and you know, for those who know of Tezuka's work, you know that especially early on he had what he called, you know, the star system, right? So there were certain characters that he created that he kind of would use like actors, so they would appear in different roles in different manga that he would create. And the one that tells the story is his name is Mustachio. And so he was from some of the earliest manga that Tezuka created. So you may recognize him if you see him. He's an older guy, kind of bald on top, but a big old bushy mustache that hangs down. And he wears a bow tie. And he's the one who guides us through Tezuka's life. And I like that. It's not revolutionary. It's not unique. We've seen things like that before, but I think it's a nice touch that we get the life of Tezuka told through one of his most noticeable creations.
Mm-hmm. What did you think of that narration? Because, you know, we talked about, you know, we mentioned that it is a pretty lengthy book, but, you know, I wasn't that big a fan of this book, and it's related to its length, but it's not just about its length, because we have talked about, you know, we talked about Akira, which is 2,000 pages long, and we've talked about, you know, we've done some, you know, we did A Silent Voice last month.
Which yeah, was, that was 7 volumes.
You know, it was 7 volumes, and so altogether it's much longer than this. But for me, this, you know, you really, really feel that length in a way that I don't think you do in some of the other long books or titles that we've covered. And for me, it is down to that narration, because it is so verbose and it's so didactic that for me, it's just not the kind of tone that I'm really interested in or kind of compelled by. So I was curious what you made of that, the way that narration is produced and included. Is that something that you thought was kind of to the detriment to the book, or?
Well, in responding, okay, there are two things I want to say about the reading experience. And, you know, one definitely has to do with the narration that we were discussing just now. First, let me say, though, that in terms of the reading experience, this was not the easiest thing to do, or not the easiest text to read, physically speaking, just because everything is in one volume. And if I remember, because it's been a little while since I read the introduction, you know, Frederik Schott, who translates, does this introduction at the beginning, which is pretty good. Mm-hmm. And he mentions that I think this had been published in multi-volumes, or at least 2 volumes originally in Japan, but that for this English edition, they decided on 1. Well, you know, I'm wondering if maybe putting this entire book, the Osamu Tezuka story, into 2 or maybe even 3 separate books, maybe as a box set, would make it a little more manageable. And by that I mean, just for me, holding the book. Now, it's paperback, so you don't have the weight of a hardbound cover. Actually, a hardbound cover might even have helped a little bit, because then the book wouldn't flop over as big as it is. It's just at times it was a little difficult to pick up and hold in a comfortable way. And, you know, this is by far not the only book that we've discussed on the Comics Alternative where that's been an issue. I mean, a classic example of this is Chris Ware's Building Stories, right? I mean, there's some components to that. I think there are 13 pieces total that are just difficult as hell to hold. Same thing with some of the more recent books from Ben Catcher. They're really large books. Or you could say, you know, you mentioned Gary Panter earlier. We haven't discussed him on the show, but, you know, if you read Jimbo and Purgatory, you know, you have to hold that thing up or set it down, because it can get your arms tired. So something similar going on with my reading experience with the Osamu Tezuka story. Just a big book to hold.
Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, we even talked about on Tezuka and big books, we even talked about a couple months ago, those Message Adolf books, and those are in 2 volumes, but each one of those is
right,
is about the same size, the same, you know, thickness, the same page count as this book, but you're right, you don't have that problem, because it is a hardcover, and so it's not it feels sturdier in your hand.
Right. Now, getting to, you know, what you really asked me about, and that is the effect of the narration. I didn't really have a problem with that, I guess, given the kind of book that this is. And this is not, I would say, definitely not a critical biography, of course, and it's not a more objective biography. It's one where I think the creating parties had a very high stake, and understandably so.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to go off to something else, but let me finish this thought. So because they had such a stake, it seems to be the deck seems to be stacked toward praising and honoring the memory of Osamu Tezuka, which is fine, because I kind of went into this book expecting as much. And so the narration, where you have Mustachio guiding us through his life, that I think goes hand in hand with this reverential tone. Mm-hmm. And so it seems almost as if, you know, everything about Osamu Tezuka's life was positive, was uplifting. I don't think this man did any wrong from this, you know, if from everything we gather from this book. So because of that tone, I think the narration works well. Mm-hmm. But if you came to this expecting a more even-handed graphic mm-hmm. biography, then I can see where Mustachio's narration of all the events can be a problem.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's necessarily that I was expecting like a critical biography or anything like that. But I think for me that I want to hesitate from saying it's bad because you're right. It is that the tone, the way that narration is kind of pitched and the way it functions as part of the book is consistent with the ethos of the book. And so I don't want to be overly critical of something that, you know, is totally fine and acceptable and stuff like that. But I think just for me personally, I think that is not that kind of pedagogical, polemical, the way that it's included in the book is just something that for me personally is not something that I'm really thrilled about. It's not the kind of tone that I really gravitate towards. But I do think you're right. I think it is consistent with the rest of the book and what the book is actually trying to do and accomplish. Yeah. But
it's interesting because as I was starting the Osamu Tezuka story, I was just wrapping up Bill Shelley's biography of Harvey Kurtzman, and mm-hmm. as fate would have it, I finished it the day after it won the Eisner Award this mm-hmm. past Friday. So, that's a big book as well, and I had started reading it about a month ago. So every now and again, just, you know, going through it. Now, I mention that because, you know, one, there are two biographies that I was reading at the same time. You know, one is more traditional, you know, of course, a text-based, not a manga version of a biography. But also Shelley, who does other biographies as well and really well, he is even-handed in his representation of his subject. So, for instance, we got to see the less than attractive, not the salacious, but the, you know, less ideal side of Harvey Kurtzman as well. That, you know, the mm-hmm. guy was a great idealist, a great humorist, a great cartoonist. As a businessman, he left a lot to be desired. So we get to see this side of him. To contrast this with the Osamu Tezuka story, everything about this guy from this that we get from this book is good. It's, in fact, mm-hmm. not good, but great. And after a while, I have to admit, I mean, I like this book overall, probably a little more than you did, but that kind of almost saccharine treatment of the subject matter started to get on my nerves after a while.
Mm-hmm. Right. It is essentially, you know, hagiography. You know, I don't know that much about Tezuka's life to say, like, hey, why didn't you include X, Y, and Z? But, you know, I'm sure there were a couple, you know, missteps he made in his life, mistakes, you know, just like if I was reading a biography of Hayao Miyazaki, I would expect to see, you know, because he's talked about his kind of failures as a parent, the fact that he gave his children short shrift, he paid much more attention to his work, he was neglectful of his wife and family. I would absolutely expect to see that, you know, part of the book and you don't really see anything even similar to that in this, where it's very much about how Tezuka is good and cool and hardworking and so impressive, and he's the god of manga, and he is kind of elevated to this level. He's deified in a way, which
exactly.
Which, you know, thinking about it, isn't that surprising, given that, you know, one of the credited authors is Tezuka Productions. So, you know, it stands to reason that they have something to gain from this kind of Tezuka uberalis propaganda, essentially.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned the creators behind this. And so, yeah, part of the creative team is listed as Tezuka Productions, and so that's a collective body. But also, we have Toshio Ban, and I guess I guess I got this from the introduction, from Schott's introduction, that Toshio Ban is someone who had worked alongside of Tezuka, and he is the actual artist of this.
Yeah.
Am I mistaken, or is that correct?
No, that's the impression I got too, and I was trying to find more information about Toshio Ban before we started, and I wasn't really, but I was able to discover that he is. I was able to discover that he's currently practicing as an independent artist, and so I kind of inferred, like you, that he was the person who actually drew the book. Though,
oh yes, it is. In fact, I just turned to page, Roman numeral 11, and they do. Yeah, he's the artist of the book. So
okay,
right.
But the impression I got from Schott's introduction, because Schott talks about Toshio Ban, I believe, going and interviewing people and doing research, and so I got the impression that he was also the quote-unquote writer as well. So I think Tezuka, I'm not sure in what capacity Tezuka Productions, whatever that means, actually worked in the production, the artistic production of the book. But yeah, I also believe that Toshio Ban was the person who drew it.
And the thing about Toshio Ban is that his style is very much that of Tezuka. So, you know, if you know you're familiar with Tezuka's work, then you could, and you didn't know who created this, you may pick this up and think, "Huh, okay, well, this is some more Osamu Tezuka."
That's interesting that you say that, because one of my problems was that Toshio Ban wasn't. He seemed to me to be attempting to emulate Tezuka without really being successful at it. You know, I thought there were a couple instances where he does an excellent job of kind of approximating Tezuka the way Tezuka draws figures and faces, particularly the way Tezuka draws himself. You know, there's a couple scenes where Ban reverts to this very cartoonish style that Tezuka himself would employ to draw self-portraits, where he had a circular head and he had this kind of bulbous circular nose that I think Ban clearly demonstrates he can emulate Tezuka's style effectively. But throughout the text, he seems to be doing this kind of like second or third rate Tezuka-influenced style, but it never really got close enough to me to be convincing as Tezuka, but it was not far enough away from Tezuka to have that kind of distance. So it was kind of in this space where it was too much like Tezuka, but not enough like Tezuka for me. That kind of it didn't make the reading experience difficult, but it just kind of was something that I did keep thinking about in the back of my mind as I was reading it, that's probably not to the benefit of the book.
Yeah. We started off talking about the length of this text, mm-hmm. and another thing that strikes me is, and I wanted to ask you this as well, I felt that in places the scenes could have been significantly condensed. Yes. Did you feel that way as well?
Yeah, I felt identically to that. You know, there was, I think, Toshio Ban, who I'm going to go with as the person, unless someone can provide other information to contradict it, but Toshio Ban.
You mean as the writer?
Yeah, seemed to be do his due diligence and research this book exceptionally well. It is filled with details, you know, historical and biographical details are full of citations and footnotes, references and citations and quotes from Tezuka's actual work and from essays and biographical manga that Tezuka himself produced. You know, he seemed to do the research work required to make all of these details accurate and precise. And I think that is to his credit. But at the same time, I did feel like you, where he seemed to put all of that research on the page, you know, every little detail,
he wasted every little thing.
Yeah. Right. It's just full of so much detail, and I understand the interest in doing a cradle to grave story of Tezuka, but he really doesn't just do the dramatic or important or kind of pivotal moments in Tezuka's life or career. He hits every little one. You know, there's like a 30 or 40 page sequence where Tezuka wants to go to South America and Easter Island, and he works out how he's going to manage his schedule, and he draws 30 pages or whatever, and then he gets on a plane, and the plane comes back because there's a fuel leak, and then another couple days goes by, and he's able to get on another plane and get to Chile, and then to his trip to Easter Island, and it really is full of these details that, like you, I felt were just totally, totally unnecessary.
Right. Now, we've talked before on this show, both on the manga series and on our regular review show, that, one of the things that distinguishes manga from, let's say, American or Western comics in a larger sense is that there is kind of a slower pacing in that you have more story that unfolds and the narrative has time to breathe. I think here you have an extreme example of this. There's too much breathing going on.
Mm-hmm. Right. I tend to like those decompressed moments,
right,
but I tend to like them when they're used for things like, I think Ichira
Oda.
Right. Or even like, I think Ichira Oda, who draws and writes One Piece, I think he devoted something like 300 pages to a single fight sequence. And that guy, I'm not a huge fan of One Piece, and I've only read, a little bit of it. I do give him a lot of credit for being able to draw really convincing and interesting and exciting fight sequences. And so, 300 pages for fight sequences decompressed that much is something I'm totally on board with. Or the thing Taiyo Matsumoto does in Sunny, or, there's a couple of people who do that same sort of thing, like Inio Asano, or... God, I'm blanking on these people's names, but where they will stretch these brief emotional moments, and they will heighten those emotions, and they will stretch them out over, instead of one panel, there'll be a page, or instead of one page, there'll be two or three pages, stuff like that.
Where, right, like narrative close-ups.
Right, where they stretch these moments, and they heighten them, and they just make them more visceral and impactful. That I'm totally on board with, but this seems to just be... I hesitate to use the word decompression because it's not a single moment stretched over a long period of kind of diegetic time or whatever you want to call that, one moment of story stretched over several moments of reading.
This is like one of those examples, almost like the running time and the screen time are the same. It's like watching Hitchcock's Rope or that episode of Seinfeld, Chinese Restaurant, right? Where every single thing is played out. And after a while, like halfway through this book, I'm going, oh my God, it feels like every moment of Tezuka's life is
right,
being revealed.
Right. This, whereas I think a manga, when it decompresses a moment, it's more like slow-mo, where this is more like the kind of rapid editing that you see in something like Edgar Wright movies, like Shaun of the Dead or Hot Fuzz, or Darren Aronofsky's Requiem for a Dream, where they take 30 seconds and they try to pack image after image after image, and just to get it all in there to make sure you see all of these images, that you get all of this kind of visual information. And so I would hesitate to call what Ban does in this decompression. It seems that he's just stuffing it and overstuffing it, kind of like a turducken almost, mm-hmm, where it's just full of its details that are interesting, that I think people who may not be as familiar with Tezuka can get a lot of information out of. But they don't really add anything to this kind of narrative about Tezuka's life, and nothing meaningful.
Right. Now, in this book, the life is divided into three major sections. And the first part covers Tezuka's life from 1928, from birth until 1945, and it's called From Osamu to Osamushi. And you know that gets back to his love of bugs, his entomology. And then part two covers 1945 to 1959, dreams of manga. And then part three, which is the longest, it seems, or at least it feels that way, from 1960 to 1989 in his death, dreams of anime. And that's roughly, especially with those last two sections, where things go. Because we have the setup of his early life in that first part. And he starts to draw manga in part one, but then it's not until part two that things really take off for him, and we see the, according to the text, the meteoric rise of his art, and especially his reputation, which I want to talk about in a moment. But then we get into part three. There's something about his work in or his plans for animation in part two, but then once we get into part three, it definitely delves into the founding of his studio and his work with, let's say, Astro Boy. In fact, I have had the tune of Astro Boy in my head all day long. because of that. But so yeah, it is divided fairly evenly, I guess, in terms of his life. Now I wanted to talk about, as I mentioned a while ago, his reputation. And one of the things that really stands out in part two, and after a while I have to admit that this was kind of getting on my nerves, the fact that he was so sought after that Tezuka would take on too much work, where the editors would try to track him down to get the pages that he owed them, or that they would hang out in his home or his apartment until he finished. And there were several editors who were just hanging out, waiting, and sometimes they would play Mahjong or sit around and read or shoot the bull, waiting for him to finish the pages. So this is a guy who is so, so successful that we have editors not taking him to task for being late, but just thanking him dearly for taking the time to give them the pages that he owed them, even though he was very late. And, you know, that may have been the case. I'm sure it was. I'm not doubting the accuracy of this. But after a while, I thought, oh, my God. I mean, it's I hate to keep mentioning Trump on this podcast, and unfortunately, I've been doing that a lot lately. It's like when Trump said, you know, it's gotten to where I can, you know, shoot someone in the middle of Fifth Avenue and no one would say anything. It's like, you know, Tezuka can completely forget a commitment, or he cannot turn in a story. You could be late, and it wouldn't matter because he's Osamu Tezuka, and everybody wants his work. And again, that may have been the case, but it again, this is an example of that part of his life being overplayed.
And it is, you know, reading this was, and reading that section and those passages was totally mind blowing to me, simply because there's it was some Tezuka book that I think Frederik Schott also translated a number of years ago, and I believe it came with a DVD that had like a 45-minute documentary about Tezuka that that I originally saw on YouTube, and I send to you so you can include it in the show notes if you'd like for our listeners. But it's actually just a really great short documentary about Tezuka, and takes you through his process and what his day is like, and you know, there's one scene where he like comes home from like a big party in his honor at like 11 or 12 at night, and the cameraman asks him like, what are you going to do now? And he gets home and he takes like these 8x11, you know, white printer paper sheets, and he starts folding them and grabbing pencils, and he says, well, I've got to turn in, you know, 10 pages by tomorrow morning. And so the fact that this guy was churning out 10 to 20 pages a day, and that he was still late on anything is that's the amount of work he was taking on, is totally mind blowing to me.
Yeah, almost psychotic.
Yeah, it's, you know, and I think at that point in the career, he would run away, and we see a little bit of that in the manga. He would run away from the editors, and he would the editors would be the only people who knew where he was, and they would keep him in like an apartment that only they had the keys to and no one else could get to just make sure he he did his work.
Right, but that seemed to be common practice with some publishers. We saw that a few months ago when we were discussing A Drifting Life.
Right, yeah. And in this, because it covers such a long period of time, you do see the kind of development of what is now the kind of common manga production system, where you have, you know, people just destroying their body and not getting any sleep and being hospitalized because they're doing 15 pages a day and they've got a bunch of assistants. Yeah.
Yeah. What was that? What was the one manga artist early on that ended up dying because he was a rival of Tezuka's?
Oh, I can't recall his name, but I know who you're talking about. That's not uncommon. It's very common for cartoonists in Japan who at least do, you know, people like Taiyo Matsumoto do a monthly series and they do all their work by themselves, or Shigeru Mizuki would work very slowly. And there's an interview with Naoki Urasawa and someone else where he quotes Mizuki saying, "All my peers would brag about only getting 3 hours of sleep a night, but I get 8, and look at me now, I'm like 91. And so there are people like that who work more slowly, and they work, you know, monthly or bi-monthly magazines.
And are more healthy.
Right, and they're allowed, their schedule isn't as hectic, but you see other people like Takehiko Inoue, who does Vagabond, and he's done like Real and Slam Dunk, and he's been hospitalized a number of times. So it is very common for under this production system for these popular, hardworking artists to become hospitalized. And you see that developing in this book, in the time period that Bond covers in this book. But Tezuka, I think, he produced pages at an unbelievably – still, you know, we think of as 15 pages a week as an unbelievable number. But he was producing, you know, 40, 50 pages a week at some points, and that's just totally insane to me. And then the fact that he would produce them, you know, he produced 2 pages on folded 8x11 printer paper, you know, is another detail that just is so different from what we expect and what we see, you know, American cartoonists producing, that it's just insane.
Right. Oh, by the way, the name of that artist who died was Eiichi Fukui.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's the one who died young just because of the mistreatment of his body, you know, not getting enough sleep, eating, all of that. So, and we do get a sense that at that point, according to the biographer, that Tezuka realizes, oh, I should not take it for granted or my health for granted and should be a little more careful on what I do. Of course, I'm not sure after that if he seems to have learned his lesson because he still pushes himself. But again, I mean, that feeds into the Tezuka mythos, right? I mean, that this is a guy who is almost godlike. I mean, he's called the god of manga, right? But he's presented here as godlike in that he could – you know, get no sleep. We're constantly getting reminders that he's pulling, you know, 2 or 3 nighters at a time to get things finished, that he's traveling all over the place, that he still has time to see 365 films, movies in a year's period, taking on more work than he needs to, and he still gets out alive. So, I mean, there's something – I don't know whether to admire the life of Osamu Tezuka or to read this with a gigantic nugget of salt, wondering, you know, how much of this is being sugarfied and prettied for the consumer.
Right. I mean, it's definitely true that he did produce all that work and he produced it at an incredible rate. But thinking about it now, it's possible that he may have suffered from like graphomania, where he was just simply unable to, like Stephen King almost, but to a greater degree, where, you know, it's almost compulsive that they have to produce a certain amount of work.
Right, but not just in terms of the output, but the fact that it doesn't seem to disrupt the relationships in his life with his parents, with his wife, with his the editors that he works for. You know, everybody is just hunky-dory when it comes to this. And so, again, there's a part of me that really doubts this story. I mean, there has to have been more darker things going on, more negative reactions to this, but we really don't see it in this. Now, do I think that's necessarily a flaw of this book? Not necessarily, given I think what it attempts to do. And this gets back to what we were discussing earlier about the narration. You know, when you first open this book and you see that one of his own characters, Mustachio, is the one who's telling the story, and that this is also partly authored in some way by the Tezuka by Tezuka Productions, and that Toshio Ban worked with Osamu Tezuka, you know that this is going to be a loving portrait of the man.
Mm-hmm. It is. It's and I agree with you. There is. It has certain goals that I think it accomplishes, but I personally would have liked to have seen, because you're right, I believe that because of his popularity, he was able to maintain those relationships with like people like editors so easily. But the idea that working that much didn't severely impact his relationship with family members or his wife or his children, things like that, I think there's probably more to that story. And that I would have liked to have seen, but it's also interesting that he died of cancer, I believe, instead of, you know, this crushing workload, which I mean that's just me marveling at real life. Maybe he was just more. He was better than normal people.
Yeah. And you mentioned his death. And by the way, to our listeners, this is not a spoiler. Yes, Osamu Tezuka did die. So we have in this very last panel on page 869 an image that I kind of knew that was coming. Here we have this image of Tezuka, his head, you know, as an older man in the sky. And it looks like it's set against a backdrop of something almost like a sun. But of course, there is the phoenix that is right there underneath his head. And all of his characters are on ground level looking up at him. So again, a god figure here that we have. So it didn't surprise me at the end. But I don't know. I mean, again, I like this book, especially for what it is. I didn't expect anything otherwise. And I do recommend this, but it is a long read.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's another thing that that I wanted to touch on. You mentioned that it is divided into sub or three kind of sections that cover this kind of distinct or distinguished portions of his life. And I was interested in what you thought about the way that it was organized, because usually, you know, with a couple exceptions. Usually the manga we read is demarcated with the chapters, and you can tell where it was originally broken up for serialization.
Right.
There's chapter headers and chapter titles and chapter numbers. And so you get a really strong sense of how it was originally serialized, and you get these good points that are good for stopping if you don't want to sit through and read the whole thing through. Whereas this, you really only get those three kind of sections. And I was thinking about it, and I think for me that was another contributing factor in the fact that I really felt the length of this book, because it's not organized so that it's easy to kind of stop and start and put it down and pick it up and read it over the course of a number of sittings. It's designed and really encourages you to read it in these kind of big bursts and these big chunks. Do you think that contributed to you in any way, your enjoyment or kind of... Would you think it was something you liked about the book, didn't like about the book? What was your kind of take on that, the way that was organized?
Yeah, that's a good question. I do think that it affected the reading experience. I would have liked to have seen more narrative beats that were clearly defined, and not necessarily in terms of the serialization pauses, as you were mentioning, that we have in most of the manga we've discussed, because of the manner in which it's serialized. But I would like to have had more stop and start points within each of those three parts, because if no other reason, it would give me, let's say, a preliminary marker to pause, put down the book, and do something else. Because in my experience in reading this, I would be into one of the parts, and I would look for a place to stop because I had to go do something like make dinner or get ready to go to work or whatever the case maybe. And so I would look for a place to stop because I like to get to stopping points. Maybe I'm a little too anal that way. Mm-hmm. And so I would have liked to have had chapters within each of the three major parts. I mean, I think it worked okay without it, but you're right. Without those breaks, without the chapters, then it did seem rather longer. I think it kind of fed into that experience of this being a really long almost burdensome narrative.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was. I'd say I felt similarly, and I do feel similarly about you, as you with, you know, wanting to stop at those quote unquote good stopping points. So, was there anything else about the book that you wanted to touch on, or do you think we've?
I think that, you know, the word exhausted maybe not be the most appropriate, but I think that this is an exhausting book, but in a good way. I mean, you and I have been talking about some of the drawbacks that each of us have had, or the experiences that maybe hasn't been as encouraging with the Osamu Tezuka story. But it is a really good book. It's, again, I'll say this, one that I would highly recommend. It's just a long haul, and despite some of the things that we've said, it does give a good picture, a good introduction at least, to Osamu Tezuka and his life and art. So two books for this month that are actually quite curious in that they're both new books, but they deal with a more historical subject matter, either older stories that are now being made available in English, as is the case with Red Red Rock, or the story of a manga legend with the Osamu Tezuka story. So we started off with Seiichi Hayashi's Red, Red Rock and Other Stories, and then we talked about the long biography, The Osamu Tezuka Story, A Life in Manga and Anime by Toshio Ban and Tezuka Productions. There you go. A lot of reading for this month, Shay.
Yep, a lot of reading.
Yes. And if you want to find deals on manga, then you would do well to visit the website of our sponsor, which is Discount Comic Book Service. Go to dcbservice.com. You'll find a variety of comics, manga, and otherwise. And after you do get your manga there, get in touch with us and let us know what you think about this month's discussion. If you go to the website, comicsalternative.com, you'll find that you can leave us a voice message through SpeakPipe, which is really easy to use. Or you can call us the old-fashioned way by dialing 415-3-COMICS. That's 415-326-6427.
You can also email us at twoguys@comicsalternative.com, or you can email me specifically at shay@comicsalternative.com. And Derek, where can they email if they want to get a hold of you?
At derek@comicsalternative.com. You can also find us all over the social media, such as Twitter, Facebook, Tumblr, Instagram, Google+, Goodreads, Pinterest, and YouTube. You can subscribe to the podcast through iTunes. You can stream us on Stitcher. You can also find us on TuneIn. You can now listen to us via Spotify and, if you're an Android user, Google Play Music. But you know, you can still find every single one of our podcast episodes, as well as the many reviews and comics-related commentary that we post on our blog, by going to our website, comicsalternative.com. All the ways, Jay. All the ways.
All the ways. I think last month I told people that I would stop making fax machine jokes, but I haven't come up with an alternative. So.
And I do have a fax machine now. I just inherited one.
Oh, that's right. That's yeah. We talked about that. But we haven't set it up yet.
Yes. So if someone does want to fax the Comics Alternative, give me a heads up and I'll make sure to connect it and turn it on. But until that point, we'll be back next month with more manga. I'm Derek.
And I'm Shay.
We'll see you later.